Hi, everyone. My name is Matthew Pohl. I'm Director of Enrollment Strategy and Associate Director of College Counseling here at Whittle School and Studios, Hoi Tong. And I'm here to take you on a journey through the college admissions process from the perspective of U.S. colleges and universities. Today, we will speak about my background. I will offer some unique advice about the application process, going through each of the pieces and parts. I will give pointers on the interview process, and we will also discuss different types of colleges and universities, from the small liberal arts to the medium and large size universities that characterize American higher education. I'm delighted to be speaking with you. Thank you for tuning in. I came here from the University of Pennsylvania, where I was Associate Director of Admissions and Coordinator of Global Admissions for nearly 4 years. I oversaw evaluation and selection of applicants from China, Canada, and the Mid-Atlantic United States. As a result of that experience and previous experiences at the College of William and Mary, where I was assistant dean, working closely with the Confucius Institute there and our global recruitment committee, I also worked at Sarah Lawrence College in New York, a small selective liberal arts college which sourced students from across the world. So I came to Whittle with a unique experience and a unique set of perspectives. As a result of that, I'm able to share that with all of you today as we go through the pieces and parts of the application. Thank you. So the timeline for U.S. colleges and universities typically starts in the 9th or 10th grade. When it comes to looking at the pieces and parts of the application, you have standardized test preparation, extracurricular planning, essay drafting and writing, requesting letters of recommendation, transcripts with grades, and submitting the final application itself, which is typically online. Along with this comes the early decision and the regular decision application process. So let's actually talk about the different parts of the application that I outlined first. Most students are able to take standardized tests as early as the 10th grade, typically with the PSAT. The PSAT is kind of like a practice exam that allows for students to really get comfortable with aspects of standardized testing. The PSAT also allows for colleges and universities early on to target students that might be within the realm or a good match for their school based upon their scale of scores that they receive. When it comes to other standardized test preparation, such as the SAT and the ACT, many students start early as well. I typically recommend that a student as early as the 9th grade simply purchase an SAT or ACT test prep book. They answer a couple of questions per day. They start to get used to the language. They start to understand the structure of each of these exams so that by the time they take a full practice test or two, typically in the 10th grade, and they take their first administration of these exams, typically at the beginning of the 11th grade, that will allow them to earn the highest score that they can possibly receive. A lot of it is based upon comfort and preparation. Many families also choose to spend money for test preparation as well. I argue that it's okay to do both, although early on for a student to really be independent and exercise their ability as individuals, buy a test prep book first. Advanced placement exams as well tend to be a part of the application process and a growing part of it as well. Many students will self-study for APs, having not taken them. My recommendation is to self-study, of course, for math and science, subjects which often come easily to students in China as they have rigorous studies in those areas already in school. But I recommend that in order to really impress admissions officers, that students really gain some foreign language, particularly English language experience, to study early on for the humanities and social sciences-based AP exams. That will really help admissions officers to know that Chinese students have better English skills moving forward if they can achieve a 5 on any one of those social science exams. Let's go on to extracurricular planning. A lot of students, particularly in China, believe that if they can list as many clubs and organizations as possible on their applications, or if they join a large WeChat group, for example, or if they kind of go off on their own to do a project, that will help stand out. I actually recommend something different. When it comes to what top colleges and universities are looking for, we want consistency and leadership and bridge building within a team of students. So organizing a project within an already established club or organization when you're in ninth or 10th grade at school in China or any other country, and then actually leading that project into major research or to national recognition may in fact be very helpful and will set you apart and will show that there is demonstrated passion and consistency in what you are doing. I would also recommend this within community service. I would also recommend this in leadership based on athletic activities as well. Club-based athletics are actually growing in prominence and popularity across Asia. These are areas that admissions officers are very much paying attention to. Letters of recommendation from teachers and counselors. I know that some of you may have large class sizes depending on the schools that you're in, but really get to know your teachers. Try to attend events with them during school or after school that are appropriate for students. Try to stay during extra help sessions if you have any additional questions on the work that you are doing. I would even advise this for classes that you may not necessarily be as passionate about. Try to understand from a teacher what are the big questions in the field that experts are asking, in not only in math and science, but also in history and the social sciences as well. That may inspire you to take a different direction in your extracurricular activities as well, and it may inspire other students. When it also comes to asking for recommendations from teachers who are reliable, who will really tell your story, ask teachers to focus on 2 or 3 successes that you have had in their classes. This will really give admissions officers a very clear story of what you've been able to accomplish during your time in those classes, typically in the 11th grade up until the 12th grade as well. Admissions officers also do check for inconsistencies in recommendations. Admissions officers, particularly at highly selective colleges, me included when I was at the University of Pennsylvania, would email teachers. We would even look for phone numbers. We would look for evidence that what a teacher was saying in the recommendation would match up with what the student might be writing in their extracurricular section. So I absolutely give the strongest advice to all students to be as honest as possible when they ask for their recommendations. Do not embellish. Do not tell untruths. Be very, very ethical in your approach, because ethics are aligned with your name as a person and your personal brand. Finally, submitting the application itself online. The common application is, of course, the most commonly used application that US colleges and universities take. There are now over 600 colleges and universities that accept it. Others include the Coalition application and the Universal application as well. Those applications, all of them in fact, typically open later on in the summer, usually in August, sometimes September of your senior year is the time when you could get started working on them. And then in the next segment, I'm going to take you through early and regular decision processes, break those down, and tell you what they mean. Thank you.